Now, for our next presenter, you've already met her as our tech guru for the evening. Talking about her love for her sock knitting machine, we have the Comic Con past president, Sheeri Cabral.
Thanks, Amanda. A few months ago, I was lucky enough to get an opportunity to buy a used circular sock knitting machine. I bought a 2006 New Zealand auto knitter, also known as an NZAC. Everyone I know who's seen one of these in action wants one. We see it cranking out a tube and we think, wow, super fast. In fact, I can crank out a 100 gram skein of sock yarn, about 470 yards, in 10 minutes. But that 10 minutes just makes a large tube, not a whole sock. And even then, there's a lot of work that needs to be done to get a good tube with all the stitches in it. Before the cranking happens, we need to prepare the yarn. The knitting machine takes up the yarn very quickly, and the yarn needs to be unencumbered, like from the outside of a comb lifted straight up. And here you can see my little helper winding a comb. Once your yarn is wound, you have to thread the machine. On the next slide, you'll see two threads together coming up in the back, going through the machine. At the bottom, you'll see the yarn going through the coil. There we go. The yarn going through the coil and then a curved barrier type thing called the yarn guide. From there, the hooks catch the yarn. The position of that yarn guide is very important. It needs to be far enough away not to touch the hooks, otherwise you'll break them, but close enough that the yarn coming out gets caught, otherwise the knitting doesn't happen. Then you cast on using a cast-on basket, which is a whole bunch of hooks. You wrap the yarn around each hook in the basket of the machine back and forth, and you put a weight in the basket. So then you can crank. But cranking isn't easy either. Sometimes you end up with a huge mess, like that bottom picture. There are a lot of reasons why the hooks don't catch. The weight could be stuck and not weighing things down. The yarn guide could be too close or too far, and the yarn might not be feeding smoothly. That part in the front of the green box is the tensioner, and you screw that top part up or down to loosen or tighten the tension. Wrong tension also causes messes. It is very disheartening to be cranking along and see a dropped stitch. Because you have that heavy weight on it, you don't just drop one stitch, it goes down all those rows, 10 rows or more. It took me about 15 hours of playing with the machine just to get a tube that was consistent. So there is a big learning curve. But a sock is more than a tube. You have the toe, the heel, the ribbing, and the ribbing, and they're all possible to do on a sock machine, but that takes more skills, more parts, and more time learning. When you first cast on for ribbing, you only cast on half the stitches, which you'll see in the next slide. The special ribbing attachment does the purl stitches, and the cylinder needles do the knit stitches, so you only want every other one. So not only do you have to stop the fun cranking to put on the ribbing, but you have to put the ribbing needles in those slots. But that will fill out the missing stitches. The ribber also has a ton of adjustments to line up the ribbing needles with the empty cylinder slots. So the yarn guide needs to be perfect in two dimensions, not just near and far, but up and down, right? Grover is very important here, right? Over, under, and through. So you need it as far away from the cylinder, far and close to the cylinder, as well as up and down. And from there, you can have fun cranking on the ribbing. Once you're done with the ribbing, you have to stop and take time to transfer the ribbing to the cylinder needles. So you have to put in the rest of the cylinder needles, and then you have to transfer the stitches themselves, which it takes a long time because you're transferring the stitches, right? And I do it with a dental implement that you can see there on the bottom. It takes a long time. Once that's done, you can crank away at the leg of the sock until you get to the heel. The heel is the fiddliest part, but I'm better at the heel than the ribbing. One way to do a sock heel is to take half the stitches, do a bunch of decreases, then do a bunch of increases, like in that diagram. And you can see where the blue and yellow lines kind of end up in the sock. So you can do this with the sock machine, but it takes a bunch of fiddling, which is not as much fun as just sitting there cranking away making a tube. So to make a heel, you raise up half the needles so that they're not used. I marked my cylinder in green where the halfway points are, so I lift up all those needles between the green marks. The red marks in the middle are where we're going to decrease to, because we don't decrease to a point, we decrease to a section. Next, we need to put tension on the yarn. So we move the yarn from where it is on the top left, that's how we cast on, to putting the yarn in the hook, like on the right. The picture at the bottom shows what happens when I let go. The hook puts the tension on the yarn. And we're still not ready. We need to weight only the working stitches. So we have this weight that's been weighting the entire tube. Now we need to use these heel forks, which are a bent fork with a lead weight at the bottom, and put them on the stitches. And we put them on the inside of the tube there, so it's only weighting the part we're working. Now you can decrease, but you don't just crank away. You crank half, and then you lift another needle up, and that doesn't decrease. And then you crank half back, and then you lift another needle up, and that's how you just keep going and repeat. So it's not just crank away, crank away. And as I go along with the heel decreases, I have to move the heel hooks inwards to pull on the right sections, because if you have the heel hook here and you're decreasing, eventually you have to move it to here. So you can see now that the picture on the left, you can see that they're moved closer together. And the picture on the right shows all the heel decreases done. See all those needles up. And then we have 12 stitches still down. So then we start to increase. The increases are done similarly. You crank one around to one side, and then you push the needle down so it starts to work again. And then you go to the other side, and you push the needle down, and you go back and forth and back and forth. Of course, this is still a lot faster than manually knitting it, so it may be fiddly, but it's pretty good. Once you get back to the green marks where we started, half up, half down, the heel is done. So you push down the needles and continue cranking. The toe is similar to the heel, except you graft the two sides together instead of continuing to crank. So that's the story of how to make a sock on a circular knitting machine. There's lots of adjustments to make to get things working right, and there's lots of fiddling in between that satisfying cranking. Please make sure to join me after all the talks. I brought my machine, and you too can crank out a few rows.